The analog character of Mixbus can be attributed to its signal flow. The combination of EQ, channel compression, and tape saturation make for a warm, punchy sound that makes in-the-box mixes come together more easily. Mixbus uses a floating-point engine. This means that it's essentially impossible to clip once audio is in the box. Through maintaining optimal recording levels and managing your gain staging like a traditional analog mixer, you'll find that mixing is faster and easier. Getting a great sound starts at the tracking process. When recording in Mixbus, we want to make sure that our tracks aren't clipping on the input. A good rule of thumb is to shoot for peaks of around minus 15 dB full scale. That way our recorded elements can jump plus 10 dB or more without clipping. And don't fret too much if your tracks are quieter. We can add more gain in the box with no artifacts later. If you've clipped the waveform when recording, then bringing the fader down will lower the meter level, but it won't make the clipping sound go away. So to achieve an optimal sound, we need to make sure we do not clip our inputs. After either recording or importing our regions, our first stages of level control are clip gain and gain automation. Gain automation is a preferred method of level control for film mixers. It makes it really easy to adjust the volume of phrases or pieces of dialogue, but try it sometime with a vocal track. You'll find yourself using less compression on it. The next stage of level control is the input gain knob on the mix window. It sits right above the fader for easy access. If your track was recorded a little too quiet, you can compensate for this at the beginning of the channel by turning up the input gain. You can also use input gain to attenuate a track if it was recorded so loud that you can't adjust your compressor or plugin threshold sensibly. Like most DAWs and plugins, Mixbus's compressor threshold and tape saturation effects expect your signal to be below 0 dB. If your levels are too high, then you won't be able to sensibly meter your signals or control your compressor thresholds. Next up in the signal path is the fader. The most common use for a fader is to balance the levels of your tracks during mixing. Faders are better than knobs here because you can quickly see the overall levels of your tracks related to each other, but only if your previous gain staging was set up so that the levels are actually telling you something. This is a great motivation to use the input trim knobs to get the playback levels into a similar range. This is how tape recording worked. Signals were recorded as hot as the medium would allow to avoid the noise floor, which meant that at the input of the console, the levels were pretty similar. The fader gets its name from its original purpose, smoothly fading a track in or out from silence, which was hard to do with a rotary knob. Older workstations only had fader level controls, which meant that the fader was used for all volume tasks. Mixbus has gain controls at multiple points of the signal flow, which means we can use the right one for the right job. If you want to make rough gain changes, region gain is a great tool to use, and it lets you draw directly on the waveform for sample accuracy. Fader automation is the right place to make the slower, artistic changes that showcase different tracks during different parts of the song. Next up in the signal path is the compressor. We have detailed compression in a previous episode of Mix Tips, so go check that out when you get a chance. If the inline compressor is engaged, your next stage of level adjustment is the makeup gain control. It is commonly used to restore volume that is lost when compressing a signal, but it can also be used to add gain once all other stages have been tweaked. Sometimes this is useful if you've already automated the fader and you just want to tweak the overall level of a track post-fader. Continuing with our signal flow, most of your tracks will be assigned to one of the 8 mix buses. Each mix bus has a tape saturation stage which emulates some of the desirable effects of recording to tape. For example, traditional meters were not able to convey the real dynamic range of a snare drum. The initial transient was not shown on the meter, so the engineer might record the signal hotter. The tape would saturate the high transient, but the rest of the signal was recorded louder on tape, which would raise the effective level of the snare drum. In contrast, we are often looking at digital meters when we are recording. These meters can catch every single peak of the transient, so we are likely to record the drums at a lower overall level. Engaging the tape saturation feature can help us bring the average level of the drums up. Harrison's tape saturation also provides modest low-frequency distortion. This can thicken up the track by adding harmonic density in the lower mid-range. This helps to raise the perceived loudness and density of a track without making it sound harsh. The tape saturation meters do not monitor level. Rather, they monitor distortion. Note that turning up the knob will not increase the volume of the track. It will just add more saturation. It's okay to push them a little bit. Mixbus can be driven or overdriven just like an analog console, but we want to keep the meter from living in the red, because the digital artifacts will become obvious. It's better to perform a smaller amount in multiple stages, and this is more analogous to real tape recording anyway. If you don't want the sound of tape, the saturation knob allows you to effectively disable it. At the leftmost settings, the tape saturation will pass the full dynamic range of 24-bit audio with bit accuracy. Keep in mind that there is an additional stage of soft clipping on the master bus, because in traditional tape productions, there was a two-track master tape, which introduced its own colorations to the mix. You might find yourself getting a little loud before the master bus. We all know this problem. Everybody wants more me until the whole mix is louder. To offset this level, we've included an input gain control on the master bus. This places the signal back into a sensible range so that our meters, thresholds, and fader levels are able to better help us manage our mix. The master compressor comes next. The functions are exactly the same as channel compression, but the application may be different. We can add some more glue to the mix with a few dB of gain reduction using the compressor character, or add a little peak limiting with the limiter compression character. When combined with the next gain stage, the makeup gain knob, the master compressor has an audible loudness effect on our mix. The master limiter is our safety net, as it keeps us from clipping our final output. Because of its low distortion and slow release, the master limiter is not well suited to mastering for the loudest tracks, but it can help to transparently attenuate loud spots. It allows us to work with a safety net while we wrangle our mix into shape. The bright yellow indicator and the reduction in volume tells us we are reaching the limits of our available headroom, and the selectable look-ahead function allows the limiter to catch peaks with even less distortion than a hardware limiter. Practicing good gain staging is the key to becoming a better audio engineer. Good recording techniques combined with sensible level control will make for a better overall mix. We've laid the foundation with Mixbus by giving you the best analog-style signal flow available in a digital audio workstation.